I had taken Mrs. Prest into my confidence, and it was she who offered the happy suggestion that the way to become an acquaintance was first to become an inmate. Simply ask them to take you in on the footing of a lodger. The Mrs. Bordereau lived in Venice on very small means, unvisited, unapproachable, in a dilapidated old palace on an out-of-the-way canal. Mrs. Prest herself had been established in Venice for 15 years. In the early years of her residence, she had heard the elder Miss Bordereau was ill and had a suspicion that she was in want. She had gone to the house to offer assistance. The niece received her in the great, cold, tarnished sala, the central hall of the house, and did not even ask her to sit down. This was not encouraging for me, and I remarked as much to Mrs. Prest. She, however, replied, "Ah, but I went to confer a favor, and you will go to ask one. If they are proud, you will be on the right side." And she offered to show me their house. I had already been to look at it half a dozen times, but I accepted her invitation, for it charmed me to hover about the place. Jeffrey Aspern had never been in it that I knew of, but some note of his voice seemed to abide there by a faint reverberation. Mrs. Prest knew nothing about Jeffrey Aspern's papers, but she was interested in my curiosity. As we went in her gondola, with the bright Venetian picture framed on either side, I could see that she was amused by my eagerness. "One would think you expected to find in them the answer to the riddle of the universe," she said. And I replied only that if I had to choose between that and a bundle of Jeffrey Aspern's letters, I knew indeed which would appear to me the greater boon. One doesn't defend one's God. One's God is in himself a defense. I said that he was no doubt not a woman's poet, to which she rejoined that he had been, at least, Miss Bordereau's. The strange thing had been for me to discover that Miss Bordereau was still alive. "Why, she must be at least 100, I had said. But on coming to consider dates, I saw that it was not strictly necessary that she should have so far exceeded the common span. But she was very far advanced in life, and her relations with Jeffrey Aspern had occurred in her early womanhood. My fellow worshipper John Cumnor and I had done more for the memory of Jeffrey Aspern than anyone else by opening lights into his life. His early death had been the only dark spot on his fame, unless the papers in Miss Bordereau's hands should perversely bring out others. There had been an impression about 1825 that he had treated her badly, just as there had been an impression that he had served several other ladies in the same way. Each of these cases Cumnor and I had investigated, and we had never failed to acquit him conscientiously of shabby behavior. He was not a woman's poet, as I had said to Mrs. Prest, but the situation had been different when the man's own voice was mingled with his song. That voice, by every testimony, was one of the sweetest ever heard. Every one of Aspern's contemporaries had, according to our belief, passed away. Most dead of all did poor Miss Bordereau appear, and yet she alone had survived. It was a revelation to us that it was possible to keep so quiet as that in the latter half of the 19th century, the age of newspapers and telegrams and photographs and interviewers. The only secret of her safety that we could perceive was that Venice contained so many curiosities that were greater than she. The gondola stopped. The old palace was there.
"How charming! It's gray and pink," my companion exclaimed.
It was not particularly old, only 2 or 3 centuries, and it had an air not so much of decay as of quiet discouragement. "Though you can pass on foot, scarcely anyone ever thinks of doing so," said Mrs. Prest. "Perhaps the people are afraid of the Mrs. Bordereau. I dare say they have the reputation of witches." I forget what answer I made to this. I was given up to 2 other reflections. The first of these was that if the old lady lived in such a big, imposing house, she could not be in any sort of misery, and therefore would not be tempted to let a couple of rooms. I expressed this idea to Mrs. Prest, who replied, "Dilapidated old palazzi, if you will go out of the way for them, are to be had for 5 shillings a year. And as for the people who live in them, they live on nothing, for they have nothing to live on." The other idea that had come into my head was connected with a high wall on one side of the house. A few thin trees with the poles of certain rickety trellises were visible over the top. The place was a garden, and apparently it belonged to the house. It suddenly occurred to me that I had my pretext. I sat looking out on all this with Mrs. Prest, who wished to know why I had not the resource of simply offering them a sum of money down. "Dearest lady," I exclaimed, "the old woman won't have the documents spoken of. They are personal, delicate, intimate. I can arrive at the papers only by putting her off her guard. Hypocrisy and duplicity are my only chance. I am sorry for it, but for Jeffrey Aspern's sake, I would do worse still." And I told her what had happened to John Cumnor when he wrote to her. No notice whatever had been taken of his first letter, and the second had been answered very sharply by the niece. Miss Bordereau requested her to say that she could not imagine what he meant by troubling them. They had none of Mr. Aspern's papers, and if they had, should never think of showing them to anyone on any account whatever. She begged he would let her alone. I certainly did not want to be met that way. "But you will have to change your name," said Mrs. Prest. "Juliana lives out of the world as much as it is possible to live, but nonetheless she has probably heard of Mr. Aspern's editors." "I have thought of that," I returned, and I drew out of my pocketbook a visiting card, neatly engraved with a name that was not my own. "Doesn't it occur to you that even if you are able to say you are not Mr. Cumnor in person, they may still suspect you of being his emissary?"
"Certainly, and I see only one way to parry that."
"And what may that be?"
I hesitated a moment.
"To make love to the niece."
"Ah," cried Mrs. Prest. "Wait till you see her."
"I must work the garden. I must work the garden," I said to myself 5 minutes later, as I waited upstairs where the bare scagliola floor gleamed vaguely in a chink of the closed shutters. I had been let into the house after pulling the rusty bell wire by a maidservant. I took my false card out of my pocket and begged her to hand it to her mistress, having first written on it in Italian the words, "Could you very kindly see a gentleman, an American, for a moment?" When the little maid pushed forward the heavy door behind me, I felt that I had a foot in the citadel. She padded across the damp, stony lower hall, and I followed her up the high staircase without an invitation, and took up my station in the sala. She flitted at the far end of it into impenetrable regions, and I looked at the place with my heart beating as I had known it to do in the dentist's parlor. Fine architectural doors were surmounted with old, faded, painted escutcheons, and here and there in the spaces between them, brown pictures, which I perceived to be bad, in battered frames, were suspended. With the exception of several straw-bottomed chairs with their backs to the wall, the hall contained nothing else. I had not meant that I must myself cultivate the soil of the tangled enclosure which lay beneath the windows, but the lady who came toward me might have supposed as much from the way in which, as I went rapidly to meet her, I exclaimed in Italian, "The garden! The garden! Do me the pleasure to tell me if it's yours." She stopped short, looked at me with wonder, and then, "Nothing here is mine," she answered in English.
"Oh, you are English. How delightful," I remarked ingenuously.
"But surely the garden belongs to the house."
"Yes, but the house doesn't belong to me."
She was a long, lean, pale person, habited apparently in a dull-colored dressing gown. She did not ask me to sit down, any more than years before she had asked Mrs. Prest, and we stood face to face in the empty, pompous hall. Her face was not young, but it was simple. It was not fresh, but it was mild.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.